Well, hello. This is day 9, and what a day for me to talk about what I'm about to talk about now. I talked to the Lord as I was visiting with one of the people who I call a mentee or a mother to her in the spirit. And one of the things that the Lord was ministering to me about as we talk, you know, one of the greatest things that we can do is that is to unwrap the gifts. We have got to unwrap the gifts. The gifts are in the house. And we've got to unwrap the gifts. Now, this is one of the things that is really passionate to me, especially being an apostle, one that develops and releases leaders. And that's one of the things that we got to get prepared for right now, for those who are really, really trying to build kingdom, those who are really trying to equip the leaders to, you know, understand their gift and to know who they are in kingdom-minded purposes for their lives. We have got to look inside the house. We've got to make sure. Now, does that mean you need to be an apostolic house? No, that doesn't mean that, even though we are in the apostolic reformation right now. Wherever you are, if you love God and you are doing kingdom-minded work and you are reading the Bible and delivering the message soundly, it's okay. Your ultimate goal is to unwrap the gifts and to empower and to affirm those gifts that you know that God has shown you that those gifts need to be equipped, those gifts need to be released. Now, I don't want to get ahead of myself because I really want to talk about one of the things we need to start thinking on is greatness. One of the greatest things we can understand that God has put greatness in all of us. You've been where you've been, pastor, a leader, and you know, one of the things that I want to remind us is that this message I really want to focus on are pastors or leaders because one of the things I found out is that people don't want to unwrap gifts where, you know, people may be under their leadership or under their covering for fear that they may leave them. I talked about that a while back. And one of the reasons why I'm so passionate about this is because of where I've been. We have got to understand that unless we do what I call the Jethro plan, we have got to do the Jethro plan. And that Jethro plan, what it does, it gets us to understand that we are not going to be able to do everything. And sure, we've had those who played us and did things in past times that has caused us pain, or in past times who went ahead of God and not, you know, were very rebellious and were a renegade or whatever and went on somewhere else and didn't do what God has said to do. But many of us, because it had been done to us, well, we were not blessed out of wherever we were, that those leaders did not bless us out, we tend to hold people hostage because we were not blessed out. Or we tend to feel that they need to go through whatever it was, that hard taskmaster, that hard leadership that they went through to make sure that they don't birth out bastards, that they don't birth out those rebellious type of leaders. But what we got to know is that you know that you can see the eye of the greatness in that person. You know that God has equipped you to be able to see what the heartbeat of that person is. So you need to start unwrapping the gift. I don't want to preach. So let me slow down. I want to talk about when we think about those areas where we've been. When we think about, we always talk about Elijah and Elijah. When we think about the greatness in Joshua. When we think about all the different things what David did and so on. We think about where they were and where we've been and all the hell holes we were in before, you know, we got to really, really have our gifts exposed and released. And many times people try to camouflage our gifts. And so we got to make sure that when things are being covered up or things are being put in a different light when it's really not what it is, God looks at that. And so we need to make sure that we flow in the spirit of excellence, that we flow in the spirit of reproduction. You need to keep that in mind. Our ultimate goal is to build kingdom, build leadership for reproduction, for kingdom building. And that's what I want to share with you today. Just a few nuggets on what we need to consider as we begin to think on unwrapping the gift. Just keep remembering that, unwrap. But that word unwrap means that you're going to take something. Now, that something is a soul. You're going to unwrap. That same thing that we try to do when we are being led by God to sow in, we are now sowing. That means now we are taking layers of hell off. We're taking layers of grave men clothes off. So you are unwrapping something. You're taking off the paper, if you think of it in the natural, tangible way of a gift. We're taking out the paper. We're taking out the plastic. We are taking the covering off, whatever's around it. And that means we're fine-tuning those things, those edges that need to be, you know, those kinks that need to come out of it so it can be wrapped real, real good when you get through with it. It's wrapped in the anointing that you know that it's inside the gift. I don't want to preach. So anyway, as you begin to unwrap the gift, because you have watched it, as they said in the old days, you sat back and you watched them. You looked at everything that you know that needed to take place concerning that individual. And so now you know that as you begin to equip that person, you have taken that wrapping off. That means that thing that you heard before, that way you used to do. Now you pick the birth out. Sunday, you're going to birth out what you've been sitting under. This is why we as leaders need to constantly make sure that we do a counseling check on our own self, on our own, issues, so we can make sure that these things that may be changing, we don't want to deliver that down to those that we're birthing out as you unwrap the gift. I don't want to preach. Lord, help today. So anyway, as you start to unwrap the gift, as one that has a school of ministry and one that really believes in day, that means equipping them spiritually to do social action, to equipping them to make sure they do more than four-wild ministry. We are late evangelistically. We need to get very, very busy in training up and equipping the leaders to become disciples so they can go and teach those that they reach to become disciples. Isn't that what Jesus did? Lord, I don't want to preach. I thought it was something else she was going to have me to say today, but it kept coming back in my spirit. I had a conversation with her today. I started thinking about the unwrapping and then what people are late on getting these things unwrapped, getting these things where people are believe that they have this camouflage, they have this shadow of what it appears to be that they are, that they're not. And that is because we cannot see the greatness in a person because we still have some taint in our own eyes or some jealousy or whatever. Or we have this type of fear that they may make you look shame. That is because you're not doing the equipment properly. That is because you're not looking at the areas that you need to look at. So I want to share a couple of things. First of all, you need to think about is that you need to make sure that they become your number one priority, okay, as far as leadership development. You need to sit down and start having some leadership development classes, because what we're not doing is we're not having focus-based classes. That means you're focusing them that you know they need to be equipped so that they can become past being ministered to, so now they're being released to become. That's right. You're through ministering to. That means you're through pouring in this all. You already unwrapped them. Now you fix to take them from ministering to now. That means you've ministered to them about your house services gift. Now you're releasing them as leaders. Come on, I know you feel me. So first of all, you want to develop them, making them one number one priority by hosting these classes. And then secondly, you want to give them an opportunity to practice. I believe in practice. You want to make sure you practice leadership development. That means they need to prove themselves. And I'll get into that in a few minutes. But the other thing I think is very, very important for us to know as we begin to unwrap the gift, you need to make sure that you look at what can they tell you about the influences in their own life and those places where they have been. That's why I believe that in talking about closing up breaches and soul ties that are not righteous or that they have been in, that has caused them to be the way they are. And so you want to look at talking to them about maybe three or four people in the spheres, wherever they've been, where your influence has been in their lives, you know, where they've been, whether it's businesses, whether it's leaders, whether it's mentors, whatever that is. And then after you've done all of this, you need to think about maybe the next 30 days or so, you know, think about what is the plan that they have for their own lives as far as ministry is concerned. Now you're getting them the right vision to make it plain so they can give it to you so you can see. Let's see what it is that you have missed here that you can lead them in to make sure there is clarity about what you say Daddy is saying and you understand that and you can deliver that. And then are you growing personally and professionally? Think about that. Have they did any growth at all since they've been with you? Many people that are only there, they're serving. Let me turn this music down. I love to hear. Okay, don't it sound good? Listen. Mm-hmm. Listen. My God. When I play this, I get bold. Hey, listen. Yeah. That's my warfare song. That's my warfare instrument of music. Yeah. But anyway, have they lifted any loads in the past 30 days or 20 days or 10 days or 12 days? Have they lifted anything that has been very, very difficult for them in those past times to make things look a little different for for their lives and their ministry. And then you need to consider that it's time for you to unwrap it, because now you have determined, after you've done your assessment, that this person is not no longer need to be here just ministering or being ministered to. Now you're taking them to another development of leadership release. That's right. Now these people have become strong. They have suffered much. They understand. Now we ain't talking about sheep beating now. That's a whole other subject I'll talk about later. I thought that's what I was going to be talking about. I thought I did. But Daddy, I always say this is what I want you to talk about right now. Okay, during this fasting time. Because now this issue is very important, not only for myself, but when I am leading people, that means he's trying to sharpen and remind me of some things is what I got out of this when I saw what he wanted me to talk about. It's because I need to understand that some of these leaders that may come to us and come to me, I need to understand that many of them may not know this, and my expectations are very high as an apostle. We can be very strong when it comes to expectation, but we need to also remember that much is given and much required, so that's why we are very strong in that area, because we don't want to play with somebody who we know no, they just don't want to do it. They're lazy and they're slowful. That is a problem for an apostle. Yes, it is. And so anyway, those areas that we have suffered, those areas that we've been through, we're looking for strong, effective leadership. And our ultimate goal is to get you there, to make sure that you don't play around, because these lives are at stake, that you're calling yourself leading. Mm-hmm. And so why do you need to develop these people? Why do you need to unwrap that gift, Pastor? Why do you need to think about that, Apostle? Well, first of all, if you are a leader, I don't care if even if it's just a nonprofit organization. Leaders beget leaders. Just like sheep beget sheep. They attract sheep because they think about where you go to school. People always say, where did you get your ordination from? Where did you go to school from? This is the reason why when people come through our school, we're only going to teach under the anointing of the gift and the anointing and calling on my life. So when they leave you, the apostolic orders on this school, that's what they're going to be birthed out of. But whatever I don't have, you can rest assured I'm going to be recommending or telling them you need to continue this area through this person I recommend because of the order on their life. I don't do a lot of recommendations because a whole lot of people can look a certain way and ain't doing nothing. And we don't want to even leave out what I've been talking about. Ain't shifting nowhere. Just a bunch of shifts. Ain't doing no work. Ain't moving nowhere. Just religiosity. But because more people tend to lead more people because of where we are now, they sometimes lead out of the wrong vein. But we need leaders who can lead more leaders who have special social action needs. And that's why we move in that type of fashion as far as an apostolic house is concerned. But the Jethro plan, I like that. You need to think about that. That Jethro plan, one of the things that we have a tendency of doing and leaders watch us do, we tend to try to do everything. Ding dong, Dr. Murphy. When I first started that ministry out in the very, very beginning of Specified School back in 1996, I tried to do everything on my own because I didn't trust nobody to touch my baby. I want to make sure my baby fed the way I'm led to feed it, and I didn't trust nobody, even not even lick an envelope. I know I'm talking to somebody because I want to make sure that label's on there just right. For those that had served me when I was real strong, real about that, I was very OCD in that area, they might be saying, yeah, you still OCD. Might just be, but guess what? Now they have started all on my life. I'm OCD with a sword. And even now, the Jethro plan, what's very important for us to understand as I begin to embrace the Jethro plan in my life, is to understand that when I am equipping somebody or when I'm teaching somebody, when I release it, guess what? They don't want to fool with this ministry because, first of all, I pray that you do not play. Because if you play, you've already been warned. That's one thing that he told me to do. Not only do I talk to him about it, you got to sign off about it. When you sign off about it, what my daddy says is, you signed that you understood. You signed that you did hear God. You said you believe God, that you know God. And when you do that, God said, not only did you were disloyal and a liar, but you did that with my name signed on it saying, I know this is God. And when we mess up that, we always want to put God in, and we lie, and we're disloyal. What's up today? And so the Jethro plan is that we need to use what we got. Unwrap the gift in the house. And so as we unwrap the gift in the house, what Jethro understood about his plan is that there was an appropriate response to what God wants us to do. Jethro was not afraid to ask questions. He wasn't afraid to give the recommendation. Many of us won't even take recommendations from those who've been there and done that. Okay? That's why I can only tell you where I've been. That's why I'm on here now sounding the alarm during the staff meeting, you know you got to ungrab the gift in the house. Now, you heard this. You can keep on playing that game if you want to, saying they're not ready, they're not ready. And you know they're ready, but you just feel like they're just so committed that you don't want them to leave, and now you got to train up somebody else. Isn't that what reproduction does? My God, if you don't train them up so they can go and grow, then you're really not building kingdom. Because how are you going to say you're building kingdom? You got everybody in the house, ain't nobody growing up, they're still babies, or they're still holding your Bible. Lord, help us all. Come on, preach. Holding your Bible, and they got all that, packing all that oil, and they're just sitting there on the pew with a collar on. To get you to pour all this into them, you better hear me. Jethro was not afraid to ask the question. If you're a leader, if you hear me and you know that it is the hour that God has been speaking to you about, it's time for the release, you need to get with your pastor and your leader and say, I believe that it's time for my release. And I need to know that you're going to bless me out. Are you going to ordain me? Or should I go to school? I ain't trying to start nothing. I'm letting you know right now, this is the hour that we have got to unwrap the gifts. We have got to prepare the army. It's just secure. Because we are in a true war. And while the soldiers are sitting back on the pews, passing Bibles around and toting briefcases and passing water around, ain't nothing wrong with that. Hey, but you need to understand that we're in a war. And God is depending on you to prepare the army. It's secure. My God, slow it down in me. Hey, but every time I think about that, it just makes me sick when I see the kind of thing going on. And so ministry is being done for us to open our ears and our eyes to look at reason. Why would God have this person sitting there? Why would God have me doing such a thing and I'm not making, and I'm not establishing growth in the people that he puts in my hand? Jethro was not afraid to evaluate. You as leaders, we must evaluate. We must honestly address the issues that are at hand. In Exodus chapter 18, verse 17 through 18, Jethro address the issues. He said to Moses, what are you doing? This is not good what you're doing, man. You need to, all these people, you trying to do all this stuff yourself. You need to break them down into captains and kings. We don't want to do that. We don't want to break them down into fivefold. Every ministry, if you hear me and you're a leader and a pastor, you should have fivefold gifts working in your house. And if they are not being trained up, where are you in the last day church? Oh, you think you're just going to call everybody a minister and everybody a pastor and everybody an associate pastor and ain't none of them understanding what none of that means? Oh, God, I don't want to preach. Oh, let me slow it down. My God, help me. So Jethro, he didn't just critique Moses. He offered an alternative plan. That's why I call it the Jethro plan. If you look at Exodus chapter 18, verse 19 to 23. He didn't, demand it. What he did is he realized that there was something. And he said, I pray that you see what God is saying. And if you do not do this, if you think about it, these are things that God is commanding us to do. We've got to look at the people that God has put to your hand, appoint them as officials, is what Jethro told him, over tens and thousands. So now he said thousands, fifties, and tens. And then he said the nation of Israel was to be divided up so he could see how to flow this in the earth. Same thing inside the house. You flow it well inside the house to get them on the wall, the prayer teams, you know, the Bible study night team, who do this and that, who, you know who's preparing this and that. You know, why can't we do that as far as leadership times for us to teach? Why? Leadership meetings don't have anything to do with why you was late in the choir, why the sound wasn't good, why, that's not that. That's a whole, that's just a class in itself on timeliness and loyalty and, you know, character building, that kind of thing, that's not it. When you are training somebody or developing somebody, we want to use equipment then, whatever one you want to do, we're actually selectively developing classes or modules that's going to be on a specific. Let's talk about how to develop, let's just use loyalty. Loyalty is a good loyalty. How to be timely, conflict resolution, how to communicate. I'm just giving you a few things. for developing these leaders around you, it's going to be very, very important for this last day to unwrap the gifts that are already in the house. First of all, the gifts are for the house, okay? If you don't start training them, developing them inside the house, they're going to be retarded in the spirit, and then they're going to go out and embarrass you once you release them to go out and speak somewhere. It's going to be quite embarrassing because you don't even know how to do that. You're too busy doing everything else, but you're not equipping the leader. It's good that we're doing these programs, but when people are going out or doing these outreaches, but when people are going out to teach, somebody's asking them to deliver a message, and you never taught them on how to do that, all you had them do a Bible study class or whatever, I'm sorry, it's not going to work. It's going to be a lot easier for you to not be ashamed when you take it to the next dimension, and that is to develop them and equip them in those areas that you know that they have the giftings in. So you can start unwrapping that. Set the climate and potential climate for those that are potential leaders that you know that you can model, that you can show how to develop them and to feed them. You can't create the momentum unless you feed them, excuse me, daily. And that means not only just in your talk, but in your walk. And the next thing I want to cover is, you know, as we begin to talk about how are you going to be the example, one of the greatest things that you can do to influence them, you can influence them all day long and they can be impressive about, you know, your teaching and all of that. But influence is one thing, it's not the only thing. You're going to have to learn how to model and show them and demonstrate them to become leaders so they can succeed outside of the four walls. And you want to take a few minutes and think on a couple of things as far as potential leaders are concerned. You want to take a while and you want to ask them such questions as, what do you think would be the best thing that I can see that is graved in you by the Holy Spirit that anybody else can see too? What is in you that is great in you that I can see and everybody else can see too that is a great revelation that that is the type of leader that you are, whether it's fivefold or anything else? And then you want to make sure that you look at the growth opportunities. Those great growth opportunities, you want to make sure you focus on that leader because they're willing for growth. You don't want to just be somebody to just dictate to them what the gift is and it should be or they need to be doing. You need to facilitate it through these classes, what I'm talking about, so don't just be a dictator. You want to be a facilitator. You want to make sure that you facilitate these actions. That means that to demonstrate and so they can make sound decisions so they won't feel alone. You don't want to just restrict them to this certain group. You want to make sure that they are doing what you are teaching them to make the key decisions as they begin to learn how to, you know, to lead other people. And then as you unwrap the gift, you want to make sure they view the truth, that they view wisdom, that they look at all these things that is very important. So when they view truth and wisdom, they have to kiss each other. Everything throughout the organization, people begin to see that they tell the naked truth and they walk wisely. See, surprise the people with these things that all of a sudden you begin to create, whether it's dramatic or whether it's just lecture. You have got to do a blend, though, because people don't want you to sit there and just lecture to them. So as you begin to unwrap these gifts, you need to do things that are very creative to get them to be able to see where you're trying to take them for the greatness as you unwrap the gift. Just think about yourself. Think about what you've done. Think about where you've been. Think about how you serve. Because if you guard your own interests by just having them there to do what you want them to do, you know, rather than serving beyond the four walls, because it should be your ultimate goal as you unwrap this gift so that they can go ye therefore and serve as they develop other disciples to come possibly even to your own church. Why? Because sheep beget sheep, and those who are leading from where they have been fed and facilitated, God help today, then they will go and reach those others and say, this is where I was taught. This is why we don't even advertise our school. Because people will come where they know that they've been fed. They'll go and know and say, this, they're going to teach you how to do this. They're going to teach you how to do that. Before you leave there, you're going to understand how to run the ministry. And those who do not, it's because they were hard-headed and lazy and slack and smoker and did a good game of faking. And now that we didn't know it, we just said that when you want to continue, they were taught all throughout the class, you can fake all you want to, but our daddy God know who you really are, and so do the devil. And so you can play it all you want and get ate alive out here trying to pretend and perform. And so creating a climate for the potential leaders is very important. You want to make them think big, meaning not big who they are in the flesh, but how big they are and mighty that they're packing power because God said that we are super spiritual as far as supernatural. Let's say that again. As supernatural, that means we move and we flow with our power and authority. So we need to think big because our daddy is big because he said greater is he in us than he is in the world. So unless a man can think bigger, then he's going to undertake less. That means that he actually can do. He will never do all he can do until he think and know how big and bad he is to our daddy God. And then you want to make sure you teach them how to make hard decisions. Sometimes people don't know how to make hard decisions because a lot of the time the leadership don't take them through the processes that I call. The first one I call, they have to be tried. We know that we need to try the spirit by the spirit. So that means you need to be looking to see where they're flowing in and what spirit is possibly still working in them. So you want to assess that gift through the spirit to see what needs some more shaping, some more mentoring, some more counsel. And then the second thing, you want to train them. That means you want them to demonstrate. And one thing we do, we want to make sure that they have been trained. That means demonstrate. They're not no monkeys and they're not no dogs. They need to be trained. But we want to make sure that they are showing practical demonstration on what they understand through our school. And then the third thing, we're going to test them. We don't believe now, this last day, what we have been doing, we don't believe in a whole lot of written tests because people can circle A, B, C, D all day long. We believe in demonstration tests. I believe that once and before you release somebody, you need to prove that gift. That means now we got to test you. That now we got to see if we can let somebody come in and guinea pig for you. Because we need to understand to see if you're going to be able to do that in front of people and or are you going to move and flow through the Holy Spirit, not that you're performing. Let's see what you're going to do with the demonstration test. I know I'm talking to somebody. And so this is what we need to do. And so if they're not ready, then they might need to be transferred out. They don't want to go through the main focus of what I'm saying here. My time is about to line up here. But when you find that you will begin to feed these that God has put to your hand, there'll be great momentum, there'll be great strength, there'll be great leadership qualities that will come out of because of what you've done. You've taught them how to think big. You taught them how to make sound decisions. You taught them how to flow in the climate and in the measure of rule of who they are. They're not trying to go ahead of God. They're trying to do exactly what you have trained them. I don't want you to train. I just gone on back and tested them because tested means that now you have tested and you tried. And so now you want to keep providing the atmosphere for growth. You want to keep showing them what they need to be doing before they leave you. Okay, so you want to ask yourself some of these key questions, okay? Do you have a true ministry development plan that's not only for yourself that you're going to give to the people that you're leading, but what about your own personal growth? How are you growing? Are you taking classes? Are you going to develop yourself some more, continuing education so that you can grow constantly. I'm constantly taking classes. Online, I go to trainings that I know that God sent me to or I may be led to go to see if this is something that I can grow more in. We don't want to do that, though. We only want to go to church on Sunday and go to Bible study on Wednesday or whatever Bible study night we have, and that's the end of that. No. Those are truly trying to grow up and grow through leadership, equipping through those gifts that God has put inside of us, then you will go and grow in those areas, and then now you will, pour in, impart what God has given you, and then it will not be retarded because now it's gotten strength because what you already know, now you have been given more. God can trust you with more. Then the next question you want to ask yourself, am I a leader of that plan? Do you really lead that plan? Is it like Jethro, or is it just like your own idea that you don't want to add no more to what God is trying to give you? You're not trying to remember or do what you've been taught, you know. So are you taking any mentorship? Are you taking any plans you've been taught? You know, yes or no. Or if you say no, you already know you off key, because how are you not going to be a leader of your own plan? You need of somebody else's plan that you're blending in with your own plan. That's how you grow. And then the third thing, am I willing to change to keep growing? I just said that. Even if it means giving up those things that I am currently doing, some things God has to prune away. And if I'm not experiencing growth, you need to be asking God why, and then you already know the answer probably because you just probably lazy period and it's sober. Then ask yourself, is my life an example for others to follow? Is it really? Can somebody grow from me? I mean, am I doing anything that people can see that my life has truly shifted and I'm not just speaking the word, but they can see there have been a movement for kingdom building, not only in the ministry, but in my own life. And am I willing to pay the price, is the next question, to become a great leader? It's going to cost you. Yes, it is. Elijah knew greatness. Why? When he got the presence of it, in the presence of it, he knew that Elijah was what he needed. Listen to me. Elijah knew that he got in the presence of Elijah. He knew what he needed. And so many of you won't get with who you need to be with. You want to get with who you think that can make you feel comfortable or tickle your fancy or not be so demanding that you grow up. Many of you want to continue to drink milk when God is trying to give you a piece of meat. You want to continue to drink milk. But I'm telling you right now, he's holding you accountable for what you know. And leaders, of what you are not getting, he's holding you accountable as well. So the next question, am I really, really willing to what? Think about the significance of what God has been showing me all these years. Am I really willing to think about that significance? What have I done in somebody else's life? Or am I too busy? Or am I just too sick of people to even consider to do anything in anybody's life because of the way they have treated me over the years? So I ain't trying to help nobody else. You think on that. Think on nurturing. Think on, as I said before, unwrapping the gift for the best to become leaders and go past from ministering to those house services gifts to releasing those to become leaders so that they can equip others and create disciples while they out representing you. So nurturing those potential leaders, first of all, BEST is the word we're going to use this acronym in. The word BEST they put down here. Let's see, I don't know who this is by. But anyway, the letter B, they said you got to believe in them. Then the letter E, you got to encourage them. Then the letter S, you got to share with them. I know in my life you don't want to share with those who you know that need this training or this development so that they can go and represent. They represent Jesus, number one. That's why you got to make sure that you have sound development lessons that you're going to teach them because you're giving them something you believe that is kingdom. So if you're giving them something that is not sound, that is exactly what they're going to birth out. Then the letter T, you got to trust them. Mm-hmm. Well, we ain't trusting that man, that flesh. We trust in what God has given you to teach them, and we got to believe that it is all God and none of you. And then we need to make sure that these that you have decided to equip, that means you've unwrapped it, and these are the ones that you know that God wants you to take from just ministering to house service gifts to releasing for leadership. That means they have the equipment within them spiritually because they have modeled what you have taught them. That's number one, okay? The equipper is a model, you, okay? Now they can model what you've equipped them. So as you equip them, you need to be the model. And then the equipper is a mentor. You need to mentor them, not only at church time, but when they are needing it at different points in their lives. I'm not saying to hold a hand and got to answer every call. I'm saying that when you're mentoring someone, you should be able to have some time scheduled for them. They should be scheduling with you. You should have to chase them down to mentor them. That I do not do. I believe that if you say I'm your mentor, then you need to be getting with the mentor. Didn't Elijah follow him everywhere he went? Didn't Elijah be able to get the oil down because he got with the power that he saw that God wanted him with? And he was hungry for it, and he got it. But many of those that run around for other reasons, for whatever reason that is, to get with people and you're still right where you was and you don't know nothing yet, you deserve that because you're not getting with the people who could potentially take you from just in-house service ministry that you're being ministered to or doing, but now you are getting equipped to become being unwrapped so you can be equipped to become empowered. That's the next thing that you want the equipper to do. To empower you so that you can empower others so that you can become a kingdom-building leader. And then finally, do you want to answer these questions? What is the statement of purpose for your ministry? Many of you saying, I know I got a ministry, God called me. You don't even know what the purpose is. Write it down. Make the vision very plain. What is the primary need of it? Why do you think God wants you to do it? Write that down. And is there any training in place to meet that need? What do you have significant? What do you have that's so unique? I know I'm going over my 30 minutes. I know somebody need to hear this. If you begin to say that you know God called you and that you have a ministry, then you need to be asking these questions. Write it down. Right now. Write it down. What is the statement of what you're going to say that what God called you for? What is your kingdom-minded purpose? for that ministry. And then the second thing is, what is the primary need? What is so significant that you've been called to be able to prophesy to a region or to equip people about how to cater to the homeless? You know, what is your primary need that you feel, what is you seeing that the primary need is that you need to be doing it, that you, because God equips us each for all for a different thing. So what is the primary need of that organization that or that ministry that you're going to be doing? What is the primary need? And then the third thing is, is there a training in place to meet that need? Is there something in place right now in your ministry that you can lead others with? Have you written a curriculum for it? Or do you have a model that those that's going to come serve you that they can follow behind? See, everybody wants somebody to follow them, and you ain't got nothing to lead them with. Lord, help me today. Let me slow down. And then number four, what areas within that ministry have the greatest growth or potential? What do you see that can be the greatest growth or potential? Why? Because many times people are not going to pay you no attention because you can't even focus on the greatest anointing even out of your own self. And what is the greatest potential that people will follow it, that people will connect to it, that people want your service, okay? And so let's look at these particular things that are very important, that you need to look at those things that are very, very important as you begin to equip others and you think on where you may be lacking help for yourself that you need. You need to develop a personal relationship with the people you're talking about equipping, or those people that you're trying to get to volunteer for you. Then you want to make sure you choose them wisely. Share your dream with them. Don't be like Joseph. Don't share it with the haters and the fakers who say they're all for you and God bless you, I love you, oh, you the one, oh, you the bomb, I really love you, oh, you just don't know how powerful you are. Really? Those are the ones you better watch. You need to share your dream with those, all those leaders that have a dream, all those that have great leaders that are leading them, those that have great mentors, those who you want to share it with, because they're not interested in what you're doing. Most of them are not. They're not one that are dream killers and dream stealers. They that are birth the baby out. They that are midwife you out. Or they that are parent you out. They're not there trying to take nothing from you. Why? Because they know they've been assigned to you so they can help you have the baby. And that the baby don't be retarded. The baby don't come out doing things that it has no business doing because it thought it knew, but the mom and daddy taught it wrong or the mentor showed them to them wrong. But I know I'm preaching somebody. I know I'm teaching somebody. When you ask for commitment, this is one of the ones that's going to be a great walk. As you begin to get those volunteers together and those people who you say are going to serve you, ask for the commitment. This is where the rubber meets the road. This is where you really can see the true Judas and the true fakers. This is where you can really, really begin to see the big difference between interest and commitment. A lot of people have a peak of interest, but they're not committed to anything. They just want to get there to see, let's see what I can find out. And then after I get that, bye-bye. And you know what I want you to hear me, leader? You need to let them go. Because they don't understand commitment even when you taught them because of the condition of their heart. They have the wrong motive, and God is watching over that in their heart. This is the reason why they will not grow. Until they understand commitment, until they understand how to follow the leader, until it's time to be released so that you can grow, so you can understand how to communicate your need without playing games. That's why people still in shape they're in, and they can't get the wisdom that they need to grow because they're too late playing games about their selfish motives. And then you want to find out, as you begin to look at what you're going to do, set your goals for growth. Talk about that. Where is that in your plan? What is your goal for 2018-19? What is your goal for the next month, for a matter of fact? What is your goal for the next 2 weeks? What are you going to do? Are you going to start developing a support list? I mean, some people are always talking about they didn't start a list. They don't even have a support or a volunteer or a following list. Once you work on that, who's following you? Who know you? What have you done to be influential in the spirit? Write them down, and let's see how far you're going to go with just them. Because Facebook ain't going to be it. You need to be writing down the people you know that follow you, that believe in the message that God is speaking through you, and that where you are taking that your organization, your ministry for growth. Lord, help us today. And that they're willing to help the baby grow. They're not trying to be that just because, you know, let's see where she's going, she may get big. They there because they believe in the vision. You pastors, a lot of them ain't gonna be with you because they don't even understand where you're going. They need to understand your vision for growth. They need to understand your vision so they can grow from you and come out of you. Lord, I don't want to preach. This is so passionate for me. Oh God. And then you want to communicate what those fundamentals are that God has been showing you over and over again. And so there's five steps for processing those that you are going to equip. The first one, you need to be thinking, I do, okay? You watch. We talk. Come on, write it down. I do. You watch. We talk. I do. You help. We talk. I do. I help. You ain't too good, you can't help. We talk. I do. I watch. We talk. We both repeat these steps, 1 through 4, with one another until you go through those first three I told you earlier on. They got to be tried. They got to be trained. That means they're going to practice and demonstrate, and then they got to be tested. They got to prove. Okay, that's the process that you want to be thinking about as you go through these steps. And then finally, before I close, you want to realize to develop these leaders that are around you as you unwrap the gift so that you won't birth out these people too soon and they run around like vagabonds and spiritual bastards and, you know, those people who you want to call a renegade because you didn't teach them nothing. They're hungry trying to find some meat somewhere and you still want to give them milk. Okay, to develop someone is to invest in them. That means you're going to have to go ahead and write some things down. They can't follow something they don't know. So you got to invest in them to show their potential. You got to show them that you care about their personal growth and the gift that God has given them. Why? Because it's hard work, and you're going to have to do it. This is what our mothers and fathers did when they had us. They pushed us out. My mother, when she had that, they had us, and I heard I was a big baby. She said I weighed over 9 pounds. So she had to push me out. That was hard work. I can only imagine. Just think about that. We're in the number 9. It's the number of birthing. What a day to deliver this message. And so you're in the number of delivery, birthing, 9 months. So you need to consider this message today, that you need to really work hard on those potential gifts that's already in the house. And if they're not in the house, you need to start assessing where they at. So you can find out these fivefold gifts. And guess what? I'm sure you got more than 5 in the house in those fivefold. The principle is that you got to get them equipped and you got to get them ready for kingdom building. The Bible says in Galatians 4:19, my dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I believe this is what we need to be doing, helping those to continue to prepare to birth out and become equipped for kingdom building. So those gifts that they had that you begin to teach them and unwrap right there in the house, that they can go past being house servants in their gifts to being released to kingdom leadership. God bless you. I pray this has blessed you. Please share it. Love you.